Yo, what is up? It is your boy Zether. Now, as you can see from the title, this is going to be What If Deku Had Shirakumo's Powers? On the last part, I definitely saw that you guys pretty much really enjoyed this. Like, I didn't think it was going to do as well as it did, and I'm really thankful for you guys. At this point, I have a lot of comments, and a lot of people actually ended up liking this video pretty quickly. So, due to that, I'm actually recording it on the same day that I posted the first part. I'm not gonna lie, I'm recording this now because I still have this idea fresh in my mind and I still know exactly what I'm gonna do next. So yeah, with that really being said, if you guys hit the like goal today, I'll be posting it today, but if you don't, then I'll just end up uploading it tomorrow around 12-ish or something like that. It's all up to you guys. I mean, you guys are the ones who need to hit the like goal. As soon as you guys hit it, you got it. But anyways, like I said, let's get into this quick recap. So in the last part, Deku had basically discovered his quirk, made friends with Bakugo, gotten one for all, and had basically just finished taking the entrance exams. After that, he would basically go home, and once he arrives, he would basically just think that he's just gonna kind of wait things out until he gets the UA letter. Now, he would basically spend this time basically training on his quirk a little bit at the beach and doing a little bit of calisthenics to try to get his body more ready for one for all. During this time, he would be training to use his quirk in different ways. He would be trying to think outside of the box for different things he can do with his quirk, but up until now, he doesn't really have too many things. So, yeah. The letter finally arrives, and Deku actually opens it, not being worried at all, actually doing it pretty nonchalantly, being like, I know I passed, like, there's no need to worry. Once he opens the letter, he basically sees that All Might is over there, being all like, young Midoriya, you passed. And Deku is just having a huge grin on his face because his idol, he never thought that he would have his idol telling him that he's going to be a UA. All Might would then go to explain that he's actually going to be a faculty member and that he's going to be working at UA as a teacher. And this would actually make Deku extremely happy since, you know, he didn't know this before, but now he does. And he's pretty excited. Now, Deku would basically be told that he got 100 robot points, destruction points, and then be told that he actually got 160 points, getting at the top of the charts when it comes to the entrance exams, and that he actually ended up acing the written part. This is when he will basically be told that he did extremely well and that he's gonna be basically welcomed into UA. Yeah, welcomed into UA, yeah. Now, as soon as he gets welcomed, he's basically happy and he lets his mom know as quickly as possible. As soon as he does that, his mom basically says, you need to call your dad, Deku. I mean, Deku. You need to call your dad, Izuku, to let him know the good news. And Deku and his mother, Inko, will basically end up calling Hisashi. This one, they will basically begin to tell him that Deku had gotten into UA and Hisashi would actually be extremely proud of his son since, you know, Hisashi actually wanted to become a hero when he was his age, but due to his quirk, he didn't think he was going to be able to, and he's just proud that his son could do what he wanted to do when he was his age. He's proud that his son has came so far with the quirk that he has, because truth be told, Hisashi was very proud of the fact that Deku had his quirk, but he was kind of worried that Deku's quirk would be as weak as his. But seeing where he's at now, Hisashi knows he shouldn't worry about his son, and he just tells him that he's proud. Deku would basically smile and tell his father that he will make him as proud as possible. Now, this one, Deku will basically go to sleep and get ready for UA tomorrow. Now, when the day arrives, Deku would basically, Deku would basically get to class, right? And this is when he would basically see the big-ass UA door. As soon as he sees it, he begins to think, holy shit, is there giants in here? And then he just kind of rubs it off. He's like, whatever, even if there is giants, I'm still going to become the number one hero. He walks in there, and this is when he actually ends up seeing Ida and Bakugo arguing, just like in canon. But Bakugo's not really being that much of a dick. He's kind of just taking it all. But right as soon as he's about to say something, Deku walks in and grabs Ida's shoulder. This is when Ida turns around and goes, get your... And then he looks at Deku and then says, oh, it's you, Cloud Boy. He then begins to bow towards Deku and say, you are a superior student to me. And this is when Deku would say, oh, thanks, I guess. And he begins to just tell him that he should just kind of leave Bakugo alone, that he doesn't mean any bad by it, and that he's just kind of relaxing. He should just let Bakugo do what he's doing. And Ida's like, he's disrespecting property, though. And Deku's just like, it's just an object, dude. Like, I we're paying all this money to be here. You know, the least they could do is let us relax. This is when Ito would just be like, what the fuck? And Deku would just be like, I'm kidding. He'd be like, Bakugo, just take your feet off. Bakugo would kind of just tisk and be like, fine. This one, Uraraka will walk in and she'll be like, Cloud Boy. And Deku will turn around and say, oh, hey. And she'll basically look at him and say, thank you so much for saving me from the robot yesterday. Wait, no, not yesterday. At the entrance exams. And Deku will basically look at her and kind of blush a little bit and begin saying, oh, no problem. Like, I did it because, you know, he would basically get flustered. And at this point, Uraraka would be kind of confused. And Bakugo would be like, heh, Izuku. Now, as this is happening, Aizawa would actually get up off of his thing and begin to say, if you're here to make friends, I suggest you leave now. Before then, actually looking at Izuku and kind of smiling at him. As soon as he does that, the rest of the class will be like, what the? Like, that's a complete 180. This is when Aizawa will basically look at the rest of them and say, go to the changing rooms and put on these uniforms. We're going to have a quirk assessment test. This one, Uraraka will basically chime in and be like, but won't we miss orientation? And Aizawa will begin to explain that a true hero doesn't need orientation or to be told that he's doing things right. Time is of the essence, and he has 3 years to make them into the best heroes they can be. And this is when all of them will basically look at each other and agree. All of the students will basically go into the rooms, and once they arrive into the locker room, Bakugo would actually look at Deku and be like, yo, you got ripped over this amount of time. And Deku would basically chuckle and tell Bakugo, be like, you did too, man. I mean, shit, look at you. Bakugo would have actually gotten a little more physically stronger in this version, meaning a little stronger explosions. And this one, Kirishima would actually butt in and say, yeah, man, like, whoa, like, Bakugo, you are ripped. What do you do? And Deku would basically proceed to say, oh, Bakugo, he just works out a lot. And Bakugo would look at Deku and say, yeah, you got that right. And they'll then basically proceed to leave. Not gonna lie, guys, I had to stop the recording a little bit because if you heard that background noise, it was pretty loud. I'm gonna have to bounce back into it now and hopefully be on the same track of thought that I was on just a little bit ago. Now, like I was saying, Bakugo would proceed to say, yeah, you got that right. And they'll then proceed to go outside and basically go through with the quirk aptitude tests. Now, once they do that, Deku would basically be told to throw the ball. And Deku would basically say that, he doesn't really have that much strength. So, Deku, oh my god, my dog's barking. I'll be right back, boys. I will be right back. Guys, I'm back for real this time. Sorry I keep going away and coming back and going away and coming back, but I really don't want these videos to have all of that background noise. Now, anyways, this is when Deku will be called up to the thing, and he'll basically be told to throw the ball by Aizawa. This is when Deku would basically just be like, okay. And since he doesn't really have that much strength and doesn't want to show off too much, Deku would basically proceed to throw the ball up into the air and then have one of his clouds catch it. And this is when Deku would basically just have his cloud fly off as far as possible. And he would basically get infinity. Now, after he gets infinity, the rest of the people would go up and Bakugo would be like, holy shit, man. Like, when did you get this good with your quirk? Deku would basically tell him that he trained his ass off during the 10 months that they had. And Uraraka would proceed to get the infinity score as well. Now, after the entire test, I'm not really going to get into it, but during the test, Aizawa would have been smiling like a mad lad, just thinking back to his old friend and thinking about how Deku uses his quirk. He would basically begin to think to himself that Deku kind of reminds him of his old friend Shirakumo, and would basically just have a little bit of a soft spot for him, not going to lie. There's going to be a little bit of favoritism from Aizawa, but yeah. Now, after this, the scores would basically be told, and Deku would basically be at the top. Deku would win, and the rest of the scores would basically remain the same. Now, after this, let's just go ahead and get into the heroes versus villains, or should we wait? Now, after this, they would all go home, and Deku would basically be approached by Uraraka, and she would basically go up to him and tell him that she's pretty impressed by him. I mean, he's really awesome. His quirk is amazing. She'll tell him that his quirk is amazing, and then Deku will basically look at her and tell her, yeah, your quirk is actually pretty awesome too. This is when Uraraka would basically say, my name's Ochako Uraraka, and Deku would basically say, hey, like, my name is Izuku Midoriya. Now, this is when they would basically begin to walk home, and let's just say that Ida doesn't join them this time. I think you guys know where I'm going with this. Ida doesn't join in on them, and this is when Deku would basically walk off with Uraraka. As he does this, he would basically offer to take Uraraka home, and Uraraka would basically smile and say, yeah, I'd love that. This is when Deku would basically create a giant flying Nimbus, and he would grab Uraraka's hand, telling her, do you trust me? And Uraraka would basically kind of blush and begin to hop on the cloud. Now, he would basically fly her home, and the music would play. Hit it! A whole new world! I played too much. Nah, for real though. He basically ends up taking her home, and this is just gonna go ahead and I'm just gonna go ahead and say it now. The ship is gonna be Uraraka. You guys will find out why later. But Deku would basically, before dropping her off, would tell her that she has an amazing quirk and that she has so much potential if she thought outside of the box with the way that she uses it. Uraraka would basically smile and then begin to tell Deku that she'll be seeing him around and that she'll look forward to being with him, and she'll then be like, oh my god, I'm sorry. Deku would basically begin to laugh and say, no worries, like, and he'll just fly away. The next day would come around, and this is when Deku would walk into class. As soon as he sees Uraraka, she would begin to kind of turn red, and Deku would basically be like, oh, I see what's going on. Now, after this, Deku would basically just proceed to go on with the rest of his day, and Uraraka would basically lose that little thing that she had earlier and basically just go back to normal. Now, as this is happening, the end of the day would basically roll around, and this is when All Might would hop in and be like, I am here, beginning to say his usual thing and letting them know that they're basically going to be doing the heroes versus villains training. Now, when that's announced, Deku would basically have a slight smile, as well as Baku, and All Might would basically begin to look at them and say, well, to be a hero, you gotta look the part, and would basically show them the costumes. As soon as he shows them the costumes, Deku would basically have a slight smile on his face. And let's just say that Deku's costume will literally be exactly what Shirakumo, I almost said Shikamaru, what Shirakumo's wearing. He would legit have that. Now, when he's walking out, Aizawa would actually, you know, be like, psst, psst, come here, kid. And Deku would walk up to Aizawa, and Aizawa would basically look at Deku and say, hey, this may be subtle, but I actually wanted to give these to you. Now, Deku would basically look at Aizawa, and Aizawa would actually hand him a pair of goggles. Now, Deku would smile and take these from him and say, thanks, Aizawa, like, what are you giving me these for? And Aizawa would basically just smile and tell him, my old friend used to wear those, and you remind me a lot of him, and I think he would like you to have them. And Deku would then kind of smile and look at Aizawa and thank him. They wouldn't be the ones that Aizawa wears, but they would be basically the same thing. Now, Deku would wear them exactly like Shirakumo, and the outfit would be put together perfectly. This is literally his outfit, what you guys see in the thumbnail. Now, after this, Deku and Bakugo would actually be, it would be announced that Deku and Bakugo are actually going to be on the same team. And they're going to be on the hero side, and Todoroki and what's it called, Ida, would actually be the villains. Now, after that's announced, Deku and Bakugo would basically fist bump and say, yes, this is going to be way too easy. Todoroki, seeing this, would just kind of be like, you wish, and would basically go up the tower with Ida. Now, once they arrive, Todoroki would freeze the entire building, and Ida and Todoroki would just basically be standing around waiting to guard the bomb. Now, this is when Deku and Bakugo would basically devise a fairly simple plan. Deku would proceed to create a cloud and basically bust in through the window, just searching around on every single window until they actually ended up finding the right one. Now, as soon as they did, Deku would basically tell Bakugo to bust in there with a huge explosion. Now, this is when Bakugo would actually just shoot his explosion and create a wide opening. Todoroki would create a giant ice thing to go at them. And this is when Deku would basically use his clouds to become solid and just kind of hit and destroy the ice. Now, Bakugo would fly in and basically knock Ida out with a big explosion right at his face before Ida could even react, since the floor would actually been turned to ice because what's it called, Todoroki had frozen it, so it was gonna be very hard for Ida to run. So after that happens, Deku basically runs to go get at Todoroki, but Todoroki is distracted because he's looking at Bakugo, who's about to get to the bomb, so he's focused more on him than Deku, and Deku basically appears right behind him and encases him in a cloud box. Now after he does that, Deku and Bakugo actually end up winning, and it is announced the hero team has won. This basically proceeds to make Todoroki a little butthurt, admittedly. And yeah, that's basically how the heroes versus villains thing go. As for Uraraka, she ends up being with, let's just go with, who did Bakugo? Who was Bakugo with? He can't do that. Let's just say, I don't know, man. I don't even know who she was with, but let's just say that everything else doesn't really matter. Like, let's all be honest. Everything else doesn't really matter. Now, after that win, the day basically goes on, and Deku and Bakugo will actually end up walking home. Now, this is when Deku and Bakugo will be on the way, and Bakugo will look at Deku and say, "Hey, Deku, like, you really improved a lot on your quirk. What kind of training did you do?" This is when Deku would basically go to Bakugo and begin to tell him that he actually trained at Dagoma Beach to clear it and strengthen his body, as well as use the heavy objects there to make his quirk stronger and more efficient. Bakugo would actually be a little surprised, and Deku would basically tell Bakugo that, not tell him about All Might training him, but just basically give him a brief rundown of what he did. Bakugo will actually be kind of surprised and be like, "Wow, like, that's some pretty amazing training that you did, Deku." And they would basically walk home. Now, I'm just gonna go ahead and time skip all the way to the day of the USJ attack. Now, this is when all the kids will be on the bus, and Sue will actually be talking about how everybody's quirk is pretty amazing. She'll point out that Deku has one of the best quirks in the class, and Deku will basically kind of smile, and Bakugo will be like listening in on this, being like, "He doesn't have the best quirk, I do." And Todoroki will be hearing this and just be like, "If only they knew." And they would basically just be chitter-chatting about everything, and Sue wouldn't actually say anything about Deku being like All Might, since he hasn't shown his immense strength yet, or his teleporting, or the fact that he could even control real clouds. Now, Deku would basically just proceed to have a normal trip over there, and he would actually be sitting next to Uraraka. They would have actually been conversating this entire time, and Deku would have basically been telling Uraraka that her quirk can have amazing uses, and that why hasn't she ever tried to fly with it? Now, Uraraka will then tell him that she has never thought about it like that, and Deku would proceed to tell her that if she trained hard enough, she could possibly make herself fly, and maybe use some hero support items to help her glide around in the air to be able to fly, and telling her that that would be very helpful for her. Uraraka would think about that for a second and basically ask Deku if he could help her with that. Now, Deku would basically look at her and smile before saying, "Of course I can help you with that. And you guys know what I'm doing. You guys know exactly why I did that, bro. She's about to be flying." But yeah, after that happens, they basically arrive to the USJ. Now, once they get there, 13 ends up giving her a speech on why quirks can be dangerous, and Aizawa, as well as Deku and the rest of the class, will basically all just walk in there. As soon as they get there, Kurogiri would actually appear and open a bunch of gates, and this is when he would actually look at Deku. He wouldn't think nothing of him at first, but seeing the goggles worn in the way that Deku has them on would trigger a little bit of a memory. Oh, boys, I forgot to mention this. If you guys don't know this yet, then I don't really suggest watching this What If, but this goes into a little bit of a manga territory. This doesn't really matter too much, but just in case you haven't read the manga, Kurogiri is actually a Nomu, and he was Nomified, and he was the old friend of Aizawa, Shirakumo, and that's what his portal thing is. That's the reason that I ended up giving Deku the ability to teleport, because I'm just going to say that he can implement that he trained hard as hell himself, and after having One For All, basically improved his quirk to the point that he can teleport with it. But yeah, with that being said, now after seeing that Kurogiri would kind of falter a little bit, and a little bit of his real face would basically show. Aizawa would see that and basically, like, Aizawa wouldn't notice it. Nobody actually would notice it, really. Scratch that. Nobody would notice it. And this is when Kurogiri would basically proceed to teleport the kids away, and Ito would run away just like he can. Now, when Deku gets teleported away, he would basically create a cloud to catch himself, as well as Mineta and Asui, and fly them out of that area, meaning that the water villains won't actually be taken care of by them. So Deku would proceed to actually fly away and take them to safety. As soon as Deku does that, he would basically proceed to take his Nimbus, not actual Nimbus, but take his cloud to where Aizawa is, and he would basically have Aizawa's back. Now, this is when Aizawa and Deku would actually start fighting hand to hand against the other villains, and Deku would use his clouds to capture the mutations and kind of fight side by side with Aizawa. Now, Aizawa seeing Deku fight would actually be very impressed by him, but tell Deku every time he slips up, and he would actually not even be angered by this. He would be smiling, thinking, if only Shirakumo could see this. Like, this is what we would have been if he was still alive. And he would basically smile and think back on everything that could have been, but would basically realize that, you know, that didn't happen. And he would basically just accept that Shirakumo's dead, and would basically look towards the future, look at Deku, and begin to think, you can become the hero that he always wanted to be in his head. Now, as this is happening, Deku and Aizawa would basically have taken out all of the villains, and this is when Shigaraki would actually announce and tell the Nomu to go take out Aizawa and that annoying kid. Now, this is when the Nomu would basically rush at them, but Deku would create a cloud prison in front of the Nomu, and that would actually be very soft. So every time that the Nomu tried to punch through it, it would not create a hole. He would have to have a sharp object to break through it, and let's just say that the Nomu isn't smart enough to break out of it. Now, as soon as this happens, Deku smiles towards Shigaraki, and Shigaraki is just sitting there like, anytime soon, the Nomu will get out and destroy you guys. And Aizawa looks at Shigaraki and says, but not before I can get you. He will then deactivate Shigaraki's quirk and begin to start beating on him and wailing on him. But this is when Kurogiri would actually, seeing this, would teleport over there. And Deku, as well as Aizawa, would basically proceed to basically beat on Shigaraki. But this is when Kurogiri would appear. And seeing the cloud prison and seeing the clouds, that the way that Deku's using them would falter. He was about to teleport Shigaraki out of there, but he wouldn't be so sure. Out of nowhere, a memory would hit him, and he would begin to think about his past self. He would look at Aizawa, and it would hit him. And before he could even do anything, Shigaraki would then proceed to look at Kurogiri and say, Kurogiri, get me out of here. And Kurogiri, without a second thought, would proceed to open a portal at Shigaraki and teleport him out of there. Now, after this, Shigaraki and Kurogiri would have actually left the scene and fled, leaving the Nomu there to be just a brainless idiot. After this happens, Aizawa, as well as Deku, would have just been wondering what had gone on. Like, what made that portal hero decide not to just break out the Nomu and keep the attack going? And this is when Deku would proceed to think, and he would say, he would not really put the pieces together, but they would just basically start thinking of why it could have happened. They just chalk it up to that hero was being hesitant, but that wasn't the real reason. He could see a little bit of himself in Deku and decided to let the boy live. He didn't feel like letting Shigaraki have his way this time. And when they teleported away, Shigaraki would ask Kurogiri, why didn't he teleport the Nomu out of there? And Kurogiri would begin to apologize for what he had done. This one, Shigaraki would scratch his neck and say, if I could kill you, I would, Kurogiri. And Kurogiri would look at Shigaraki and say, I'm sorry, master, we'll get them next time. Now, this is when Shigaraki would basically look at Kurogiri and be like, it can't be helped. We'll get Nomu next time. This one, he would begin to talk to All For One and say, master, we didn't get them this time, but I think we can get them next time. That Nomu was weak. He couldn't even break out of a cloud prison. And All For One would begin to say, calm down, Shigaraki. In due time, you will get your goal. Now, this is where I'm going to be ending off the episode. This is a decently long one, and you guys know how I've been doing these videos unscripted. So, You know, it's definitely way easier for me to get these videos out there. If you guys continue to let me, you know, do this and you guys keep enjoying this, I'm definitely going to keep pumping content out like this to you guys. And since we're on break, I honestly have no excuse not to. So as long as you guys hit 20 likes on this video as well, I'll be posting part 3 covering the USJ, the Stain attack, and that's it. That's all I'm going to cover on the next part. I don't want to cover too much because this series is going to end really quickly unless you guys want me to jump into manga territory, which I definitely could, but that probably won't be happening anytime soon. So long as you guys keep hitting the like goals as quick as you do, this series will definitely get far. So, yeah, with that being said, Zether out.